Hello, everyone. Hi. We're going to get started. I'm going to introduce our speaker for what is our sixth lecture in the colloquium series this year. Having received PhDs in both anthropology and biology, Colin Hoag's work sits at the intersection between historical ecology and political anthropology. Hoag is assistant professor of anthropology at Smith College, where his research and teaching interests include capitalism, landscape, water, rangelands and shrubs, multi-species studies, bureaucracy in the state, migration and colonialism. Currently, he researches the terrestrial politics of water in the southern African country of Lesotho, where a multi-billion dollar scheme to export water to South Africa has generated fantasies about national economic development, as well as fears that soil erosion stemming from peasant land use could imperil the water economy. Hoag is committed to developing forms of transdisciplinary scholarship that advance both critical humanistic approaches as well as scientific ones. He is also committed to promoting a more public anthropology in his current position as co-editor of Engagement, the blog of the Anthropology of the Environment Society. Today we have the pleasure of hearing Professor Hoag's talk entitled Dwarf Shrubs of Empire, History, Ecology, and Form in the Lesotho Highlands. Please join me in welcoming Professor Hoag.
Thank you so much for the introduction, and thanks for having me here. It's an honor and a pleasure to be in dialogue with you all today. So this paper emerges out of a research problem, obviously, but also out of a kind of dissatisfaction that I've had with interdisciplinary approaches, in particular across the environmental sciences and the humanities and social sciences. And which I'll talk about at length in the paper, but I also want to mention that some of those anxieties and discomforts come from my participation in a wonderful interdisciplinary research program called PORA, Aarhus University Research on the Anthropocene in Denmark, which is led by Anit Singh and Niels Buvant. And so lots of funky kinds of interdisciplinarity are happening there and thinking across boundaries of the human and the non-human, and so I'm indebted to all of those folks there, as well as at UC Santa Cruz, which is where I did my anthropology degree. So I just want to shout out to those people, including people like Zach Cable and Donna Haraway and Katie Overstreet and Pierre Duplessis and Filippo Bertoni and Andrew Matthews and Jens Christian Svenning and many others who I have surely forgotten. So when I began developing my doctoral research project in anthropology at UC Santa Cruz, I at some point recognized that I would need to draw on ecological science to answer some of the questions that I wanted to ask and that were going to be important to my anthropology project as critical social scientist, and so after that fact, I was presented with a problem, which or a question, which is how to integrate that work or not. Or what's the status of the ecological science in an anthropology project? And there's no shortage of models of interdisciplinary scholarship out there because the concept is in such demand across the academy. And so surely there are existing models, but I found myself feeling like there was something missing from those efforts, and with some important exceptions, of course, but it felt to me as though in certain cases the interpretive insights of anthropology were flattened in order to render that data commensurate with positivistic natural science, which seemed like a dead end for me anyways, who's committed to that kind of interpretive work. Or on the other end, that I found models whereby the ecological sciences were kind of plumbed for concepts that could be deployed in to do social theory. And so in those cases, after that reappropriation, I think that many environmental scientists would not recognize those concepts any longer. And so that seemed a little off the mark to me as well, even though I'm also sympathetic to that work, and I'll do some of that here today. But or one finds lots of examples of kind of science studies critiques of ecological science, which are also important and must be done, and yet were unsatisfying to me because of the nature of the questions I was asking. So I'll just say that I have struggled with that issue throughout this research project, and I'm really excited to be in dialogue with you today about that work. And I welcome your thoughts, because it's really challenging work. So the term dwarf shrub, as it appears in the title of my talk, refers to a plant with a woody stem no taller than 2 meters in height at maturity. Dwarf shrubs have tough evergreen leaves and are generally keep their basal meristems, so their buds, close to the soil, which is an adaptation that allows them to survive harsh winters and fire. They occur in a broad array of environments globally, from Arctic tundra to the heathlands of northern Europe to the arid Great Basin of North America, often on well-drained, nutrient-poor soils. In the treeless mountain landscapes of Lesotho, where my research is cited, dwarf shrubs are common, with numerous endemic species. In Lesotho, dwarf shrubs come exclusively from two families, Ericaceae and Asteraceae, the latter of which is known for producing large amounts of seeds. Some grow rather quickly, so for example, I spotted one of the most common shrubs, Chrysocoma ciliata, growing on a berm for a new road at almost 3/4 of a meter tall, just 2 years after construction had begun. Chrysocoma ciliata has alternating needle-like leaves with disc-shaped flower heads. It grows rarely taller than 1 meter in Lesotho, and it can be found all across southern Africa. The branches are bare below and dense, with leaves near the crown. The leaves extend up to 8 millimeters long and are hairless and sticky with a sweet scent. Its seeds are wind dispersed. In this talk, I'll make the case that these formal properties, the dwarf shrub's form, not only as a figure in the anthropological sense, but as a set of functional traits, are objects of anthropological interest. In examining the landscape history of Lesotho's mountain rangelands, where shrubs are said to be encroaching dangerously into grassland pastures used for livestock production, and in examining the landscape historiographies of my informants, I came to see the political stakes of plant form in material semiotic worldview. My informants included livestock owners as well as government conservation workers, and differences in the accounts of these two groups of people regarding the causes of shrub encroachment, which focused on different parts of the shrub's body and used these to theorize different causes of landscape change, indicated that I needed to understand plant ecological relations. That is, I needed to cultivate what Anand is called the arts of noticing, to see non-human lives in their specificity and their entanglement with those of humans. In light of this, and in the context of concerns about livelihood-threatening land degradation in my field site, I turned to ecological science as a way of assessing what plant form might mean for an anthropology of these landscapes, and to understand whether the accounts of livestock owners or conservation workers were more accurate. But while helpful for developing an attention to plant social relations, ecology's theoretical sensibilities tend toward the abstract and ahistorical, removing from view the historical trajectories within which ecological laws are caught. So I found that the ecological science results were of little value without the interpretive and historical tools of anthropology. Now, anthropologists know to be skeptical of capital S science, visions from nowhere and everywhere, as Donna Haraway has put it, having demonstrated how knowledge is always situated, that it's always historically, politically, and culturally specific. And African landscape change and human role in driving it has been misunderstood by scientists repeatedly, and sometimes because of racist or anti-poor biases, and sometimes with serious political implications for land use and management. But recognizing that science is situated can't be the end of the story, because we need science. In analyzing multi-species worlds, I want to suggest that we can use ecology to learn how to see and describe nine humans as imbricated in political process and as drivers of history. So where landscape production is at the center of an anthropological question, at least, we need to develop situated scientific knowledges to envision the political and symbolic processes that lie behind landscape production, and make strong truth claims that are aware of ecological science, as well as the racist, sexist, and other tropes of unreformed science. In doing so, I think that we might show environmental scientists how to build history and power into their models of ecological process, and make critical interpretive approaches matter in conversations about interdisciplinarity. And indeed, it's my position that in a time of global ecological cataclysm, a strict aversion to knowledge claims that smack of science is untenable, and in some cases, maybe even politically irresponsible. So stitching together a variety of data on landscape change and use, I'm going to try to tell this kind of situated ecological story here today. And I'll argue that empire acts through and upon ecological formations, just as it does through social formations. The same structural forces that have ensnared people from Lesotho in an exploitative political economy for more than a century, a process that Sheila Mbembe has referred to as disjunctive inclusion, whereby black Southern Africans have been drawn into economic production in mines and urban centers while being simultaneously distanced through segregation. These same forces are at play in the ecological processes that structure plant communities in Lesotho. So I think of the space of these interacting processes as like an n-dimensional hypervolume, to draw on a concept from G. Evelyn Hutchinson, who developed it to describe an organism's ecological niche and the infinite human categories and physical factors that can account for whether an organism lives or dies and whether it procreates. Although I want to emphasize that I'm thinking about how to think about plant ecological relations in that case. And I'll suggest that the concept of form, which captures both figuration and ecological function, can help us to understand how people theorize actions or responses to disturbance by shrubs, and use those theorizations to understand how shrubs act or respond to disturbance. That is to say, something about shrubs as such. These entangled nature cultures are what Andrew Matthews has recently referred to as ghostly forms, to describe the partial historical relations across language and tree morphology that structure human chestnut forest ecologies in Italy, or even what Gene Komaroff long ago described as the, quote, reciprocal determination of material and cultural forms, but here with a reconfigured notion of the material. So to give you a sense of the structure of my talk, I'll start by explaining how shrubs have become indicator species of decline in Lesotho, and then I'll describe how two different groups of informants, government conservation workers on the one hand and peasant livestock owners on the other, describe to me the causes of shrub encroachment. And next I'll explain an ecological study that I did to explore the veracity of those claims, after giving some theoretical framing regarding the challenges posed by humanistic use of ecology, particularly with regard to history. And then finally I'll try to draw it all together and tell a situated ecological story. So it's going to be a demanding talk. There's a lot happening. Bear with me. But dwarf shrubs were not central characters for me when I first began developing this research project on the terrestrial politics of water in Lesotho, so I have to back up for just a minute. With the construction of the Lesotho Highlands Water Project, the country has become the world's first water exporter. Initiated in 1986 with the signing of a bilateral treaty between the governments of Lesotho and South Africa, the LHWP is a multi-billion dollar effort to dam Lesotho's mountain rivers and divert that water by tunnel and canal to the arid industrial regions surrounding Johannesburg. The government and other elites in Lesotho who champion the project have put forward water as a national figure of wealth and prosperity, inserting images of water into its national iconography. But opposite water, a counterfigure has emerged, the dwarf shrub. Dwarf shrubs have spread across mountain rangelands, giving apparent substance to fears that land degradation could imperil that water economy. Some fear that overstocked, poorly managed rangelands in LHWP catchments could be leading to soil erosion and the sedimentation of those dam reservoirs. And that's prompted efforts to reform the ways that livestock are grazed in Lesotho's vast highland pastures. So in effect, it's a clash between peasant livestock production and national water production. So consider the following ethnographic scene. The massive Porihati Dam is currently under construction in the mountainous Mohotlong district where most of my research was cited. And conservation workers there are concerned about livestock-induced degradation in the upstream catchment, particularly in some alpine wetlands. And these wetlands are these small areas of peaty soil that are sometimes called water silos by conservation workers because of their ability to store large amounts of water and slowly release it over the course of the year. And the fashioning of these alpine wetlands as water silos, I think, is a great example of what Ashley Carson referred to as nature as infrastructure. So conservation workers are promoting grazing associations that might help prevent more wetlands degradation. And grazing associations are basically these community-based cooperatives that are supposed to manage grazing by issuing permits to people who want to graze in one particular area or another. And they don't actually do that really, but that's a story for another time. But I visited the Hubeda Valley with a government conservation worker named Sachava, who had called a meeting of the local grazing association to encourage them in their work. And as we drove up the valley to the meeting, he pointed to the shrub-covered pastures and shook his head and said to me, "Do you see that? These people are ruining their pastures." For Sachava, shrubs were an indicator species for land degradation and soil erosion, what Keck and Lightgoff have called sentinel devices, describing and pretending decline. So we arrived at the meeting place, and the meeting started as usual with a prayer, and Sachava introduced himself, his full name, and the village where he came from, as is customary, and that village is in the lowlands district called Laribe, and he told the people at this meeting that in Laribe, people refer to Mohotlong, this mountainous district, as Di Sha Sheng, which means the place of the shrubs. And everybody erupted in laughter and shock and dismay, and there were lots of shouts and kind of comic anger, and sometimes maybe even actual anger. And afterward, he went on to berate the organization for its lack of organization, and emphasized again the importance of protecting the range. And as we drove back to town after the meeting, I turned to him and said, "John, is that true? They really call this the place of the shrubs?" Because I'd never heard that. Threw back his head and laughed and said, no, that's just for motivation." So you can see how shrubs how indicator species are produced in these specific political circumstances, and how dwarf shrubs have been implicated in this clash between national water production and peasant livestock production. But this clash isn't just reflective of urban-rural class dynamics within Lesotho. It's emblematic of a structural change in the regional political economy from labor reserve to water reservoir. So livestock have long been important to rural livelihoods in Lesotho, but more so since the collapse of the mining labor economy in the 1990s. So whereas most of Lesotho's working age men once spent a part of their adult lives working in South African gold and diamond mines, this opportunity dissolved at South Africa's transition to democracy when domestic labor was favored over foreign labor, and jobs were cut through mechanization and because of a drop in the price of gold. So today, one of the few ways that rural people can generate income is through sheep and goat production, selling wool, meat, and mohair. But while there are real reasons to be concerned about soil erosion's impact on the LHWP and the role of livestock in promoting erosion, there's little concrete evidence to evaluate the situation. Soil erosion is extremely difficult to see, measure, and monitor, and I think incredibly for a multi-billion dollar water project. No long-term studies have been conducted to resolve the question of whether significant erosion is occurring and whether livestock are to blame. Instead, a class of plants, the dwarf shrub, has come to be used by conservation workers as a kind of shorthand for soil erosion. And yet, though these unpalatable shrubs are definitely bad for livestock production, in that they crowd out grasses and diminish the amount of forage per unit area, there's no clear evidence that shrubs are linked to soil erosion, and some people even suggest that shrubs might prevent soil erosion. So, it's complicated. But Most everyday people also who live in these rural areas don't see shrubs as related to soil erosion, as does the chaba. But the dwarf shrub is still an indicator of species decline for them, specifically of a reduction in palatable forage for livestock, as I'll describe in more detail shortly. So in my field research with government conservation workers and peasant herders and livestock owners, I found general agreement on the point that there are more shrubs today than there were in the past. But in theorizing landscape change, they focused, that is explaining why that change happened, they focused on different aspects of the plant's body. And from that, they drew different conclusions about the cause of the shrub encroachment. Have you noticed any changes in the mountain rangelands over the years, or do they look more or less the same? There's a question that I asked many people during my field research, and the man I was speaking with is a former conservation worker who worked for many years on rangeland issues, and I'll call him Bokan. And we were sitting, not pictured here, we were sitting in a breezy outdoor cafe in the capital, Maseru, and he said, yes, definitely, they're badly degraded today, much worse than when I first began working. When you go to the mountains, you see sahalahala everywhere, this bitter Karoo bush, and you know what the Karoo Desert is like. The shrubs are a sign of desertification. And the response was one that I hear regularly from conservation workers and government and foreign NGOs, and he carried on to tell me about the history of grazing associations, because for him, management had been the critical problem burdening Lesotho for decades. That pastures were overstocked, and that local chiefs were unable to control grazing adequately. The symptom of this problem was the shrub, Brassicoma ciliata, known in Lesotho by its common name, sahalahala, or in English as bitter Karoo bush. And specifically, he and other conservation workers referred to two related features of the plant, its palatability and its competition for light resources. They explained that because the plants tasted badly to livestock, even goats avoided them, they were given a competitive advantage for light resources when the grasses around them were eaten. The toughness and sour taste of shrubs' leaves and their height relative to grasses around them hold forward this ecological story about their spread that made the effects of livestock almost self-evident. So it's a landscape history that he told through reference to shrub functional traits. And he felt the problem solvable through better management, which is the focus of his department. So by contrast, herders and livestock owners told landscape histories through reference to shrubs' evergreen leaves and woody stem. So a walk that I took with a man named Zupa through the shrub encroachment with Serengeti Valley was evocative of this. And Zupa and I stood on the ridgeline looking out over the valley, which is a cattle post area where people keep livestock during the winter months. And I'd asked him to take a hike with me through the area to tell me about the landscape's history, whether it had changed, how it was managed, etc. In the lower reaches of the valley, dense stands of shrubs created a mat of vegetation, and they thinned out as we reached the ridge where we stood. And he explained to me that the entire area used to be primarily grassland just 20 or so years ago. Shrubs had always been present, he said, but they were confined to small patches along River Valley and in Valley Coves. So we came upon a herder that Zupa knew, and the man asked us what we were doing, and I explained to him that I was interested in learning about changes in the landscape. And he agreed with Zupa about the recent encroachment, so I asked them, well, what's the reason for their spread? And almost in unison, they replied, Pule ali siko. There have not been rains. The rains used to come much earlier, they explained, in October, at the beginning of spring, rather than in December or January, well into summer. And when those rains do finally arrive, they fall as destructive thunderstorms rather than as rains that fall over many hours and percolate into the soil. Nor has there been much snow during the winter, Zupa added. In the past, snow would fall and melt during the daytime, giving moisture to the grass over the course of the winter. But they explained that with drought, the shrubs have an advantage. Their hardy roots hold water when the grasses have nothing. Being evergreen, too, they can photosynthesize and use that stored moisture to grow throughout the year. He hit a shrub with a stick as though to emphasize the stiffness of its stem. Plus, the man added, all their leaves can die off and their roots can still regenerate, giving them additional resistance to drought. So, two different views of the causes of shrub encroachment. Overstocking or erratic rains? Which one was right? My informant's landscape historiography was ecological in nature, focusing on plant functional traits, practices in response to disturbance in environmental conditions. And as an anthropologist, I'm authorized to interrogate discourses about drugs. But because of historical commitments within our discipline, I must leave the question of planned action or reaction to the ecologists. But shrubs aren't just symbols, they're living things. They stretch out into sun space, they poison their neighbors with allele chemicals, they soak up the soil moisture. Can we content ourselves with only investigating the human symbolic work in landscape historiography, even as our informants are raising plant practices for us? If not, then how might we investigate the shrub to account for its multi-species social life on anthropological terms? I think that we have to find a way to draw upon ecological science. After all, ecologists dedicated to explaining patterns in the biotic world have tools for seeing the relations of non-human organisms, having paid painstaking attention to the ways that non-humans act within social fields through relations of predation, mutualism, competition, etc. And I think we can do this without turning other than human species into charismatically intentional agents, as in some multi-species literature that I also love, but sometimes rankles me. Now, research in ecological science provides support for both perspectives on the causes of shrub encroachment. As described by conservation workers, the above-ground competitive advantage of shrubs relative to grasses in grazed pastures is a documented phenomenon. Ecologists, though, have also documented shrubs' ability to access more of the available soil moisture than grasses, particularly in the lower subsoil, through their extensive root systems. So I couldn't just rely on reading the ecology literature to find an answer that applied to my case, particularly as Basuta has a strange climate, an unusual climate and there hasn't been much work done in Lesotho, ecological work, that is. So I did some work of my own to explore these two different perspectives using ecological methods. Trying to understand the relative importance of different possible determinants of shrub density, I set up a study in the area where I worked, where I walked with Nsupa. I delimited a study area of about 12 square kilometers in ArcMap, which is a GIS program that does spatial analysis and allows you to create maps and whatnot. And I generated a set of random points. And at each of them, I measured shrub density, so the percentage of shrub cover in a 5 meter square quadrat. And I measured also some soil and topographic properties like soil depth, soil moisture, soil nutrient loads, slope aspect, elevation, hill position. And I then mapped the location of heavily grazed areas like the cattle posts where animals sleep and the water points like springs and rivers where they congregate. And combining that information with topography, which affects how livestock move through the landscape, I created a map of grazing intensity so that I could describe the grazing intensity at each of those sample points. And then I used regression to determine which variables explain whether a sample point had lots of shrubs or just a few. And the analysis showed that the factors which best explained shrub density were grazing intensity, soil moisture, and soil nutrients. So where livestock grazing soil nutrients are high and soil moisture is low, you're likely to find more shrubs. So in a sense, both conservation workers and peasant livestock owners appear to be correct. Livestock grazing is important, and so is soil moisture. So what are we to make of this? And first, it's worth noting that the temptation to see natural sciences as the final word is mistaken, and I can see that tendency even in social scientists critical of capital S science, including myself. Despite the quantitative character of the results and the sciencey figures that I'm showing you, ecological science results are often murky, and this is partly because ecologies are so complex. It's not uncommon for results in ecological science to explain just 30 to 40% of the variation in data, meaning that even good ecology leaves 60 to 70% of the data unexplained. And that also assumed that we measured the right variables at the spatial and temporal scale that was important to your research question. But second, the ecology results don't show us historical process. They explore the variation among variables at a given moment in time. So while they might help to explain the factors that determine how species interact with each other, They don't tell us why the species are there in the first place, nor which historical events may have given some advantage over others. So for example, the structure of a forest might be determined more by a drought that happened 20 years ago, or human efforts to prevent fire, than by, you know, competition for soil moisture in the understory. And indeed, since the rise of quantitative ecology in the mid-20th century, history has largely been excluded from view in ecological science in favor of the kind of theorizing that I described here, where variables are delimited and the relative importance of each is used to infer past ecological process. And there are important exceptions, we talk about those in the Q&A, but that is, in the main, the predominant mode. So for example, consider the topic of community assembly, which is germane to my inquiry into why shrubs are present in some proportion to grasses and other herbs. Community assembly refers to the processes by which a specific group, a species, come to inhabit a space in some kind of pattern. And one can distinguish between two primary approaches in ecological science, niche assembly and neutral or dispersal assembly. Niche assembly is deterministic, whereby the formation of communities is a function of species' various strategies for using different parts of ecological space, like specializing and exploiting one specific food source, for example. Dispersal assembly, on the other hand, asserts that communities are non-equilibrium open-ended assemblages whose formation is a function of random dispersal events. That is, the random chance that a species in a neighboring area will arrive. So in dispersal assembly, that randomness actually is referred to as history by its major progenitors. So for anthropologists, neither of these are going to work, because history is not guided by deterministic laws, but it's also not random. It's contingent, which is something different. So indebted to work by Eduardo Cohn, Donna Haraway, Tim Ingold, Andrew Matthews, and Anand Singh, among others, I'd like to suggest that the concept of form can help us to draw history and power into ecological process, and give us a language for thinking about how the specific materialities of shrubs inform their contact with environments in historic and symbolically ordered processes. So anthropologists use form as a means of thinking about semiotic. Indication, resemblance, typology, figuration. Dwarf shrub as counterfigures of national futures, as an embodiment of soil erosion or diminished forage. And ecologists also do some of that, but especially they use form as a means of thinking about functional traits. So that is how an organism's physiological, morphological, or phenological properties indicate strategies for survival in ecological space. So from Ron Heyer's life forms to Westaby's LHS scheme of leaf height, leaf area, stem height, seed mass, ecologists have sought to develop a language for understanding how plants differ in their ability to photosynthesize, transpire, and propagate, with implications for how they might thrive in certain ecological conditions and not others. So form, for me, contains within it both of these significations. I think it can operate as a ground for doing ecology anthropologically, or vice versa. For one thing, to interrogate the narratives of our informants to learn how they're shaped by historical and political circumstances, but in doing so, I think it can allow us to get inside those narratives and treat them as vantage points for seeing different aspects of material process. I hope that will make more sense in the coming paragraphs. So in this final section, I'm going to try to do just that, telling a situated ecological story. Choreographing histories with multiple lines of evidence that are fragmented and always political. So I'll take herder and conservation worker knowledge seriously, but not throw out the science and other kinds of evidence from the archives, and do a kind of interpretive triangulation in hopes of building a better interdisciplinary scientific practice. So concretely, and I'm explaining this at length so that you don't get lost in this section, what I'm going to do is situate the narratives of my informants and examine them alongside the ecological science, as well as evidence surrounding the timing of shrub spread, livestock numbers, and rainfall, to consider at once the aesthetics, the politics, and the veracity of my two informants' accounts. And I'll show that both perspectives on the cause of shrub encroachment appear correct in certain ways, but not everywhere and at all times. Livestock grazing appears to aid shrubs and outcompeting grasses for sunlight, but especially during the early decades of the 20th century, when herbaceous plants unaccustomed to grazing were suddenly confronted by livestock as Basutu began to settle the highlands, which were previously unsettled. And the competitive advantage presented by shrubs' extensive root systems to compete for soil resources seems more important in recent decades when drought and erratic rains appear more common. So first let me situate my informant's narratives. I was taken to a lot of shrub encroached pastures by conservation workers who were almost always from the lowlands. And they gave me almost exactly the same answers regarding the causes of landscape change and the solutions to fix it. The language was strikingly homogeneous, and it was basically just as Hokang had described it above, with shrub unpalatability, grazing intensity, and mismanagement at the center. And if you read descriptions of shrub encroachment from the colonial period in Lesotho as well as South Africa, you'll be struck by just how much they echo the language of these conservation workers today. And for example, my friend and government conservation worker, Masilo, also in a picture, was an eminently good person who wanted to do his job well, but he knew nothing of the history of the district where he worked, having only lived in the mountains at the time of my research for about 2 years. And nor did he have formal training in rangeland ecology. It was just rote learning on the job. In the massive Mohotong district over which his office presided, he typically visited just a few villages per week, and little of his work was devoted to learning from villagers about the history of their specific rangelands. Instead, it was mostly helping resolve conflicts over grazing land or promoting grazing associations. And when I went with them on trips, even when we visited a rangeland, we didn't stay far from the truck. It was mostly as you see in the photo here. So their narratives are characterized by a roadside view of rangelands, an interest in management, an emphasis on the personal responsibilities of herders, and an ecological language that endures from the colonial period. Now, peasant livestock owners have certainly more of a historical sensibility about the landscapes in which they live. Although these are not deep time perspectives, so I caution people against thinking in those terms, because I get that question sometimes, or a comparison drawn between these folks and like people who have inhabited the Amazon, say, for much, much longer. People who live in the Lesotho Highlands have been there for several generations, as settlement didn't begin until the early 20th century. They regularly told me that shrubs had become a problem in the previous 20 or so years when rain diminished and became erratic. And it's about the same, it's the same period during which mining labor declined dramatically, along with the entrepreneurial dreams that those earlier economic arrangements entailed. So while working on the mines, as was powerfully described by James Ferguson, families would build up herds that could pay out annually after men returned home due to retirement or injury. And herders and livestock owners' lives were deeply caught up in the political shift away from labor migration. They often described their livestock histories to me with reference to work in South Africa, either through stories of how their herds were begun when they were workers in the mines, how they sought, in the case of younger herders, to one day leave the cattle post and find one of those rare jobs in South Africa, by wanting to teach me Fanakalo, which is the pidgin language spoken in the mines, or even simply by wearing hard hats and other mining paraphernalia. So what was once a strictly retirement strategy is now a primary occupation for many. So as with the political shift away from mining, the environmental shift they describe, the droughts and delays in the onset of rains, are out of their control. So shrubs are indicators of diminished forage in a specific historical context. And their accounts of shrubs' relationship to rain represent a structural explanation of climate change and political economic change. So with that in mind, let's look at the timing of shrub encroachment. There were two periods when shrubs appeared to expand their range and population size in the historical record, once in the early part of the 20th century and again in the 1980s and 90s. And I'll talk through both of these and relate them to my informant narratives now. So no early missionary accounts of the highlands that I'm aware of describe shrub-dominated landscapes in the highlands. in pre-settlement times, and many accounts describe buried pasture. Concern about shrub encroachment in the highlands emerged in the historical record in the 1920s when the British Colonial Administration conducted a survey of then Lesotho land. And the study claimed that overgrazing was leading to an increase in shrubs set to cover 13% of the highlands at the time. So after that report, there was no data or monitoring until a study was undertaken in 1986 to describe land cover across the country. And that study found shrub cover to occupy 11% of the Mahoghlong district, completely in the mountains. And then after that, again, so little change from that first assessment. After that, there was no concern in monitoring our assessment until I did a remote sensing study using satellite imagery that found the percent cover of shrubland in Mahoghlong district to be at 23% in 1998, with little change in the years after. So a significant increase, somewhat affirming my informants' statements. So having a sense of the situatedness of informant narratives and the timing of shrub spread outlined, let's take a look at the historical evidence of livestock numbers and rainfall, which might help us to understand the tractability of a given account of shrub proliferation. So with respect to what we know about livestock numbers, grazing expanded dramatically in the highlands in the late 19th and early 20th centuries. And this was because of a few reasons, including land pressures in the western lowlands as settler colonists, white Afrikaner settler colonists, partly aided by the British, incurred upon formerly Lesotho land territories and created more land pressures. Because of British promotion of Highlands wool production for colonial monetary gain, and because of commoner Lesotho who were turning to wool production in the Highlands to escape chiefly control over pastures in the lowlands of Lesotho. So when sheep arrived in the Highlands at that time, they found a territory whose pasturage was not accustomed to intensive grazing. And scholarship in rangeland ecology is clear that the effects of a sharp increase in grazing in historically ungrazed pastures are much more significant than in those of a long history of grazing, of intensive grazing. And this is because the vegetation that's found there isn't evolutionarily pre-adapted to endure the impacts of livestock. So in essence, those systems don't have a high tolerance threshold for grazing, and they're more susceptible to the invasion of grazing-tolerant shrubs, grazing-tolerant species like shrubs. So the increase in stock during the early 20th century is clear. Livestock statistics show periods of boom and bust. We do see a substantial increase in stock numbers just in advance of the 1986 study, just as it was underway. But we should expect that the plant community at that time was less responsive to an increase in grazing than in the early 20th century. So an ecological story about livestock-induced shrub encroachment may have contributed to the second increase in shrub cover, but was likely very important to the first. But in both cases, it's not just a story about how livestock grazing gives shrubs a competitive advantage over grasses. It's one of colonial extraction, political dynamics within Lesotho society, and rangeland ecological dynamics. So without all that, we can't tell the story. So now, let's look at the rainfall data. Rainfall in Lesotho is characterized by periodic drought owing to the El Niño Southern Oscillation, which arrives every few years but with variable intensity, and that's not new. We do know that the period between 1979 and 1990 experienced the highest incidence of drought in Lesotho for over 200 years, based on the analysis of a respected geographer in Lesotho. In this figure here, we see it shows October-November rainfall as a percent of the total annual rainfall. We can actually see a trend toward greater rainfall during that period, but definitely with greater dispersion in the data, so more variability. Although this data would not capture some of the thunderstorms, this is just the aggregate. The thunderstorms described by my informants is the aggregate, so we don't know if all of the rain occurred in any of these years happened very quickly or over the course of a long, many hours of the day. So the landscape historiographies of peasant livestock owners, which emphasize the importance of drought and promoting shrub encroachment, also appear to have substance, but perhaps more so for the more recent expansion of shrubs. But again, as with the issue of livestock grazing during the colonial period, increasingly erratic rains may very well have promoted drought-tolerant shrubs, but they did so specifically in the context of labor migration decline, as the precariousness of life in the Lesotho highlands was heightened. And without both of those parts, we can't tell the story. So no data point here is a smoking gun, but it seems fair to argue that livestock grazing aids shrub spread, though probably less so today than in the past, and that drought does too, with particular significance for the more recent encroachment. So it seems fair to argue also that there's a homology between conservation worker accounts and the first increase in shrub spread during the colonial period, and another between livestock owner accounts and the recent increase during the period of the decline of the labor reserve model of Lesotho's economy. So that is, the figure of the dwarf shrub emerges out of those historical moments when specific functional traits come to matter in ecological process. So the dwarf shrub in Lesotho is both a living presence with habits and actions and consequences, and a conceptual tool for theorizing a material transformation from livable to unlivable worlds. Either a threat to water and its economic promise, as for conservationists, or as an emblem of the difficulty of Lesotho's post-labor migration economy, as for herders and livestock owners. As environmental anthropologists writing in a time of rapid environmental change, we need to develop theory and methods, as well as the courage, I think, to tell stories about landscape change that draw upon critical humanistic approaches, as well as natural history and ecological science. Environmental scientists would be better off for it, too. And we can use informant perspectives still as vantage points for seeing different aspects of ecological process while still being ready to disagree with them if the evidence suggests otherwise. Plant community dynamics only make sense in light of a historical context, because just as human perspectives are always situated, so too is shrub proliferation. It's never uniform or all pervasive, it's spatially specific. So as my natural history observations of shrub occurrence attest, dwarf shrubs are particularly well suited to roadsides, bridle paths, and other heavily disturbed areas. An important ecologist and botanist in South Africa, in fact, have suggested, like Nsupa did, that invasive weeds had long inhabited small valley coves in the Lesotho Highlands before being let out into the rangeland at large along roads and livestock paths. They moved along the roadsides of capitalist production as British colonial administrators sought to increase colonial profits, and as commoner Basutu sought to break free from political economic forces that marginalized them, whether by evading chiefly rule of lowlands pastures or by making a living as a labor migrant. Lesotho's mountain rangelands are not nature spaces disconnected from this regional political economy either. They're post-colonial, post-industrial landscapes, and the ecological interactions in those multi-species communities are fundamentally shaped by their colonial and industrial past. So excavating my informants' narratives and ecological science approaches to shrub practices, I've tried to render sensible the ecological laws that structure plant intimacies, as well as the world histories that make those laws matter. Thank you.
Archaeological site or city, because it's always a place where you take people to. say a word about fire. And I would think in most areas of Africa, fire would be an important element of press.
Yes, it's really important. And it's a shortcoming of the research, and I found that in reviews to the Ecological Science article on the topic too, that I really struggled with this in the field because fire is outlawed in the institute. So it's really difficult to generate data on when parts of the range were burned. What I can say is that the species in question, the invasive species, without exception, are able to regenerate very quickly from rootstock despite fire. So I observed this one pasture that was totally decimated. I mean, it was just a total wasteland after fire had been set. And when I returned for some follow-up research, the shrubs were flourishing once again and grew very quickly. So that encourages me to think that while it may keep them in check from growing quite large, so that might account for why, you know, for example, these shrubs in Lesotho only reach a meter when botanists will tell you they can go to 2 meters. I don't know that it accounts for their dominance in terms of like cover, land cover, but it's an important question.
We'd like to hear a little bit more about the discourse analysis that you did to come up with your interpretive project. And in particular, I guess I'm thinking, you know, about the extent to which you said that it's kind of a window onto the ecological transformations, and I think it's really great and, you know, very interesting idea. But I also wondered about the information that you came up with in terms of your own involvement as a researcher, and how the interpretation actually arose out of the discourse. Did you do only interviewing, or was there also like some naturally occurring context in which you were able to make observations about what people were focusing on? Were there other variables that appeared in the discourse besides the shrubs? Those kind of questions.
Right. There was definitely lots of campaign now. So it's not just interviews, although interviews also played a role. So I guess it was because of this deep hanging out, which people repeatedly talked about in the case of herd and livestock owners, rain with reference to shrub spread and to diminished forage, and in the context of conservation workers, livestock grazing. And so I saw that, for example, for livestock or for conservation workers. I can see that, like in the example of Sachaba, where he was, you know, really drawing a link for people between pasture mismanagement and shrubs. So that's the context out of which those interpretations emerged. But I would say they emerged quite early. I mean, it was really
well. That's what I was kind of curious about, whether you recorded it, because I'm wondering what else is happening in the discourse. Once you focus on something, it can become what you see later on.
Right.
So it's also through your interpretive scheme, and that's why I was wanting to see whether you've got some real kind of harder discourse data that might actually be a check on, you know, your initial observations.
Right. Well, I guess the extent to which the data is hard is a matter of a function of, you know, in-depth participant observation work, which the concept keeps arising, and where the ethnographer knows this is something I need to pay attention to. So had it fallen away in those conversations, then I suspect I would have let it go. Yes. Thanks for the question.
Reading the people of the highlands of their use of pasture. I was wondering if there were, if you could give us a little more background information about that, or if there are other sort of political considerations between these two areas.
lowland highland social dynamics are, you know, shoot through Basutu society for sure, and so that conservation workers would see those people as backward hillbillies without, you know, not automated the pastures, I think is like a part of that bigger conversation, or emerges from that context, right? And it maps pretty easily onto class dynamics in that the lowlands are much more prosperous than the highlands. And like I said, the conservation workers, almost without exception, are from the lowlands. And so I think it makes sense that they would have both of those biases and that they would take rote ecological knowledge as the fundamental grounds for their work. But I'm not sure if I answered your question, so I can go push me further if I have.
I was just wondering if there are other political considerations or if there is any sort of governmental attachment in the southern regions that might not be?
Well, definitely, although I'm not sure it has a bearing on this work, the government and like this ministry that manages Grazing and promotes grazing associations and whatnot is one of the primary vehicles for redistributing national wealth to people. So one of the reasons that to rural people in the highlands. So one of the reasons, not entirely, but one of the reasons that some of those people were at that grazing association meeting is because like many development projects and any kind of, when an economic opportunity arrives in the highlands, it's only wise to pay attention to it because it's extreme poverty that people are living in there. So I think that figures in that way into our discussion in this paper. And there are definitely, there are feelings among those conservation workers that rural people are kind of, you know, on the dole. You know, so I heard some of that language for sure. So they're approaching their work in that regard. So I think that might be another answer to the question. Yeah.
So it's a very ambitious project, which is tying together many things, right? The dams and the export of water, the export of livestock, and the subdivision of the wash truck. Together in different ways. I guess for this joke, the question I had on the excitement is thinking about ways in which this research contributes to a longer history that Clark alluded to off and around the degradation and soil cover loss and erosion and that, right? It goes from Eric Hobbs in 1970s work through Blake and Brookfield to a new lecture in ecology. At work, an ecology that's both made out of social and environmental histories. So back to that work, then what seems continuous with it in the sites more than the work itself is the degradation discourse that remains remarkably durable despite all that work and all this work, right? And I was wondering if you could just speculate as to why it remains so. Like, this could be in the 1980s and the pain of livestock and erosion and all that, right? So just some perspective thoughts as to why degradation discourse remains so powerful despite all the science that's been done then and now, and what might be done with that, I guess.
Right. Yeah, there are a lot of ways to kind of question. I mean, on the one hand, I think that it's a durable discourse because of the legacy effects of all of those development projects and conservation projects that were put forward in the mid to late 20th century. And so it's just kind of hard to escape them. It's a language that people still use to talk through the land and livelihoods and all the rest of it. So I because there is really degradation, you know, in that, like I said, the conservation workers, both the livestock owners, agree that the pastures don't look good. And there's definitely some concern on my part about, like, nostalgia and, you know, the extent to which people always remember things as better when they were kids and they were running through fields of tall grass and whatnot. And I think that's there, but when I consider that the historical record of shrub spread and their negative implications for not just livestock production and livelihoods, although that's so important, especially in the context of defunct labor reserves where people are living in real conditions of precarity, but also because of the potential impact on plant biodiversity, therefore also animal biodiversity, homogeneously shrub and growth landscapes are not good for multi-species flourishing. So I think there is something called degradation, even as we have to recognize the way in which we inherit that term from the people and institutions that Blake and Brookfield critiqued and so many others. And it's a tricky thing, one that I think is described really well by Ferdinand Leach in Misreading the African Landscape in the introduction of the work of doing this kind of work is really complicated because you are forced to tack back and forth between using, say, research that's been done to assess land condition and also critiquing it. So it's kind of dizzying to be constantly trying to use it as data about the thing, but also as the thing you're examining. I think that's like a challenge and an opportunity for anthropologists who are well versed in that, as you know, science studies critique. And just the political economy critique developed to the rest of it, but who also try to use ecological science, because the environmental scientists don't necessarily have that training to do the discourse analysis and to learn about the learn about power. And so I think that anthropologists who want to try to do some of this kind of interdisciplinary work to the extent that it's important for their research questions are really well placed to do it, even though they'll no doubt struggle with it.
I think related and building on this question, as someone who's doing this interdisciplinary and transdisciplinary work and sort of wanting to speak to both sides, how can you talk a little bit about limitations and or sort of where you've chosen to publish or present your work in trying to speak to these two very different audiences?
Yeah, that is critical too. Who is reading the work and what? So I have a job in the anthropology department now, so that changes the calculus had I gotten a job somewhere else. Surely, like, my approach would have shifted. So I'm an anthropologist at heart, so I want to be a dialogue anthropologist, so like intellectual and disposed to like publishing there and publishing for those people. And nevertheless, I've tried to do the work in a way that is legible to environmental scientists in order to get their attention, because I think that anthropology and critical interpretive approaches are really, really important in interdisciplinary science or in just environmental science, and never are used. And every time I've seen like or read about interdisciplinary initiatives across those boundaries, the qualitative, you know, the interpretive work is reduced to the level of anecdote, and the efforts on the part of qualitative, social science, humanistic anthropologists to comment upon the nature of, you know, the condition of the land or whatever are not taken seriously because they don't speak in the language of R square and whatever. Like, so I think that that's one of the real challenges to doing this kind of work. And so I think there's a lot, it takes a lot of effort, but I think that that we need to start doing it. We need to be able to convince those people somehow because they have a lot of money and they make a lot of decisions about that have real political impact in the world. And so if we're going to do interdisciplinary research that matters, I think we have to like attend to both of those audiences and try to find a way to inhabit the language, you know, which is also difficult, and write papers that sound, you know, that are written in that that voice, and so therefore we have to learn that voice and we have to learn some techniques and whatnot. But I think that it's important. But I think it's a very important question.
I had a slightly different question from the one about audiences, and that like I really appreciate like how you blend in various methods to tell the same stories. But I'm wondering, when we triangulate perspectives, the fact that the conservation workers believe that the herders are impacting this new national resource of water, versus the herders who believe that that's not the problem. The problem is there isn't enough water, right? And those don't seem independent narratives. So then to triangulate and say they're both right, you know, like, I'm thinking about how we, while getting the ear of ecologists, how we still stick to responsibility, like balancing perspectives and recognizing power behind it.
Right. Yeah. That's a hard question. That's a really good one. But can you restate the just like the core of the question? Because I'm not sure how to approach it.
No, I'm just wondering that, you know, how do we think about the question of water and the shrubs and all these sort of non-human agencies? And like I was saying that in your approach, you kind of take different sort of human perspectives and triangulate them to see what's happening in a non-human realm. But then, like, what about the human question?
Oh, right. So yeah, it's a question about the extent to which we can take those narratives as two different ones that aren't somehow, from the start, yesterday, already informed by each other. It's a fair point, yeah. I'm not sure how to handle it, because no doubt, they're both, they've been, both of those groups lives in Lesotho and listens to the same radio stations. And, so I think that's a question that I need to sort out, to work on, and report back later. So thank you.
Is there anybody? Just, you started the paper talking about the large dams. Then it kind of disappeared from the paper. And I'm kind of thinking, especially since you are talking to about the ecological voice, the ecological science, just looking at the pictures, and I think you also mentioned, and I'm sorry, I know very little about this landscape.
Yeah, no.
But the shrubs seem to be appearing mostly in the lower valleys, you said?
Yeah, historically confined to along the riverside and valley coves.
Mm-hmm. I'm just wondering, if you have a large dam and that kind of centralization of water, the downstream is generally, you know, affected very deeply in terms of drying up of water.
Yes.
Because you're channelizing it elsewhere. You don't have floods most of the time. So I'm just wondering whether that comes up in this research, because if you ask ecologists, and not necessarily conservation workers that we were talking about, that would be a major framing question for a landscape like that, large dams. You know. So I don't know whether you came across that kind of an issue.
Yes, definitely. That's a good question. I should have describe more carefully that my interests were confined to the highest reaches of the island, so so that the dam reservoirs don't figure until a couple hundred meters lower. But but I struggled in formulation of the project as to where I should situate myself because there are reasons that one might want to look downstream, because there are downstream effects of starving river system of its flows and changing its flow regime. But I chose
I understand what you're saying.
But which was not stated clearly.
I also had a question sort of about the initial framing. I really enjoyed this talk, and I really like the conclusion, sort of thinking about Lesotho in terms as a post-industrial landscape, and it made me think about like what is a post-industrial landscape in a context where historically, like industrial labor and the social and ecological reproduction of that labor have been disjunctive or geographically dispersed. And so then I was thinking like, okay, so how does that kind of historical production of a post-industrial landscape then help us to think about like the dam, or how does the dam help us to think about the landscape? So I felt like part of what the dam said to me is like, it's not like Lesotho and Johannesburg are not connected today. It's just that the terms of that connection and the kinds of disjunctures that are happening are different. So is that sort of, is that, I guess, the larger kind of what you wanted to convey with that framing, or how should we think about a post-industrial landscape in this context, right? Or is it post-industrial, or is it something else, a different kind of industry?
It's a great
question.
Yes, it's a great question. And I think, I really like I like thinking about these, I like the term post-industrial for thinking about science, because often when we, just the term conjures Detroit and Akron or something like that. But in fact, I think it's places also like this that were kind of like shadow ecologies, which is a term used by a scholar whose name escapes me right now, to describe those places affected indirectly by economic production elsewhere, or like Piers Blakey talked about the off-site degradation or something like that, that people look at degradation in one place and they think about degradation there or whatever, but there's actually a bunch of stuff happening that precipitated that degradation. So I'm trying to find a way to draw together that that structural story with the ecological relations, and kind of I'm searching for a vocabulary, I guess, to do that. But I like the way you've just framed it now. So I'm not sure if I have anything else to add to it, except that I just took a note on it.
One more question?
I have a question. I thought it was a great talk, by the way, and I very much appreciate the kind of critique of contemporary population ecology and how, you know, it works as a kind of substitute for space for time, and your effort to introduce a contingent history. Right? So the question I have about the contingent history and just the move that you make, because you bring in human memory, groups, you have data on historical data on livestock, you have rainfall data, but of course plants, you know, make their own historical residues as well. So I wonder if there is or could be a role for, you know, carbon isotope ratio, the pollen data or something, because there's a way in which there is a story told directly, you know, by vegetation. Paleoecology, because that's, you know, the critique of paleoecology against contemporary population ecology, that, you know, we're here, so we also, you know, can plumb up contingent history.
Yes. I totally agree. So I mentioned that there are some exceptions, important ones, and paleoecology for sure is one of them. I wanted to, and still want to, do some pollen analysis, but I just ran out of time and expertise to do it, so I'm
a student.
Yes, it's Gordon Dorr, my collaborator in the audience. I'd be very interested. Because, yes, exactly. Like, that's one of those cases. And there are movements within the cosmos.